Listen up.
Here we go. Rap Radar Podcast, Elliot Wilson.
It's B-Dot.
We're back, man, and we got Kevin Liles here, man. Yo, all yo, white.
What up, baby? What up? What
godly, up? Looking
fresh
godly
out,
up in here, baby.
Plane, man. I came to minister to you guys, man, fresh out the plane.
It's like Puff had a party that we didn't know about.
Where we coming from, Kev?
Nashville. You know, we got a lot of business down there. We got a new country artist named Bailey Bryant. Got a couple of managers, and I spoke on the National Associated Broadcasters panel yesterday, about 3,000. You know, people down there. So just had a good time.
Hey, you know? I told you when you did that book, Kev, you trying to take me out, man. Make it happen in 2005. You're out here, man.
Nah, I'm out here doing what I do, you know, doing what I do for the culture. That's it.
But 300 just isn't regulated to rappers then, obviously.
Nah, man. We got all coming. If you were at the party, you saw Holly Suspect came out there and blessed us, you know. My Name Is Human is their record. And I got, you know, Meg Mack. We got a kid named Colby. And that's, y'all should really watch Chop That Tree Down. It's a record about racial profiling. That's amazing. He's a singer-songwriter, and then probably 40 other artists. You know what I mean?
Right.
You know, we're about culture, about music. Everything we touch is going to have some kind of, like I say, edge to it. You know what I mean?
Right.
But we're about all kinds of music.
That's why I wanted to reach out. I mean, obviously, we could have you up here anytime because you have a crazy history, rich history out here. Kevin Liles, everybody knows. All they right. do their Googles. But, you know, like we were saying, 300 Entertainment just had a big bash the second year of the company. Like, we spoke to Lyor, and, like, we know how passionate he is. And I see you now, like, even more in the forefront, like, at the Thug event, I see you getting on the mic like back in the day talking your shit. I see you dancing on the thing, going up, howling that A-track. Like, I feel like you swagging it out now, Kev. What's going on, man?
It's not what I try to tell people is that you having a label or a management company or a podcast is nothing if you don't live it. And the reality of it is when something's new, you work hard to build a solid foundation. You know, a lot of people didn't understand from what we did at Def Jam to what we're doing now. We always made so our foundation was solid. So with 300, we had to pour a lot of cement. And you know me, I'm a construction worker. So I'm at the bottom trying to figure out, build these pillars. Let me put a solid foundation. And, you know, Todd, Lyor, and Raj and I wanted to make sure before we had do a lot of public facing things that we had a solid foundation, you know, on the company. So we could have had a 1-year anniversary party, but we felt, give it time, give it 2 years, talk about what we're doing, but promoting our artists as we do. So that's why you start to feel a little bit more presence, you know.
Yeah, speak on some of the successes. I mean, obviously Fetty Wap, Young Thug, like talk about that process of making those guys like stars pretty
much.
You know,
I think, you know, at a point in time, I got upset with the industry because we were making a lot of disposable music. And I wanted to, you know, I don't know how to just put out a record to put out a record. You know what I mean? It really got to say something to me. And so, you know, we went through a process, and because the game is changing to a streaming game, so we had to find our real way. And now it's really about, you know, having artists not just say make up a project, but if you saw with Thug, all the, you know, kind of content that he puts out, and you know, with what we're doing with Day Day, we're not rushing anything, we're taking our time, you know. He has a second record that's, you know, going right now. Fetty Wap exploded so fast,
hit records, baby.
So we realized we gotta lay a foundation so it won't be just so fast and go back and do some core records with him. And Holly Suspect, like I said, you know, they put their first album out, they're a rock band. It might not happen their first album, it might not happen their second album. This record right now is exploding, you know, for us. And now we're saying our next phase, since people know us for one thing, now we're going to play in the country and pop space. So we made some great signings and investments there. And the process is the same as anything. Your brand means something. But you don't only have people up here just to have people up here.
Right.
Yeah. You specifically have them up here and you ask them certain questions. Exactly. You don't tell me what to wear, but you know, you kind of make sure, you know, that it's directed to your audience. And that's all I want my artists to do, my managers to do, managers and all my employees, just think about the brand.
Yeah.
Think about your personal brand and also think about the brand and what it stands
but
for.
But you're also selective about who you sign. Just to get back to Fetty and Thug, I want to kind of just break down what makes them special, because to me it looks like Fetty came to you guys already with a lot of records that were already on their own strong, right? Mm-hmm. And you seen the guys fall back and support his vision with that, like with Trap Queen, and actually just take those songs and make them bigger. Can you speak on like connecting with him and what he brings to the table?
I don't believe that we make stars. I think that we invest in brands and businesses. Fetty Wap is a business. And if you talk to Ned or Danny, they treat it, you know, like a business. So his business model was, I have a sound that's unique to the industry, unique to, similarly when Nelly came, you know, I have a different sound. Who am I to judge what the sound is and change the sound and tweak the sound and make it, that's not me. I'm here to support entrepreneurs and support artists fully. So that was one thing. The same with Thug. Thug has a certain aesthetic and style about him. Migos and Quality Control, they have a certain aesthetic and style about them. Day Day and Diddy, they have a certain style about them. So I've just never came from the mindset of making an artist, empowering an artist, giving them all the resources, standing next to them, knowing when to bump them and say, yo, we ain't doing that. And knowing when to empower them and to focus them on the prize in hand. You know, it's about your art. Forget just being an artist, be art. You want to be in the Smithsonian Institute of hip hop culture. And that, to me, is what I push artists to do.
Wow. Was it a humbling experience, considering your background, Lyor's background, starting from scratch with 300?
I mean, I've been doing this since 32 years.
Right.
I can get no more humble than being in it for so long. So to me, opposite. It was more so we went from, you know, 15 people early years a long time ago, up to 4,000 people. Wow. Down to 3,000, and then down to 20, might be 28 people. But it's a lot of bureaucracies out of there. If I want to get something done, or Lyor wants to get something, Todd wants to get something done, yo, we're going to do that, all right? Okay, everybody good? Great. It's across the cubicle. Right. It's not, you have to go to four floors, or this person, is it a board meeting? No, we are the board. So to me, it's fun again, and I get to go and spend time with Sha Glizzy and say, hey, Hefe 2, I think we need to come right back. I could talk directly to him. I don't have to talk to the president and the head of A&R. I'm talking right to him, and I think that artists need our tutelage, our mentorship, and more importantly, our guidance as we navigate these crazy waters right now in the industry.
Right.
Yeah, I remember one office, Lyor had like a cubicle, and it was like, this is Kev's office here,
yeah,
and he would have meetings in Kev's thing, and I'm like, wait, you don't have your own big lavish office like back in the day?
No, we don't. Listen, Lyor's cubicle is right there, and mine is right across from him. Oh, we have pods of desks, offices that you can go into if you need to have a meeting, but we want to be in the pit of it. You know, we have a responsibility, Elliot, to the next wave of Elliots and Kevs and Rap Radars and Def Jams, and I think that we got to be in it with the kids to the point that they understand that this is something we want to preserve, you know, and we want to have space for more kids to come in. So we have to be mentors. So I'm in the thick of things with everybody. That's why you see me right next to the artist talking to A-Track on the stage, down in the video shoot.
But you look like you're having fun with it. Like, there's different sweat with it. Like,
I can just tell you, I feel like I'm 25. Hmm. I honestly do, with the energy of the people at the office, the artists. I mean, you know, good, bad, ugly. You know, when you get we get Fetty stopped me in the middle of the after we did the pinata, he said, "Man, I just want to tell you thank you. Just want to thank you. I'm always going to tell you thank you because you guys changed my life." For a text that I'll get from Johnny from Highly Suspect, "Man, I didn't know you could introduce people that well on stage. I want to take you around with me everywhere." You know, what I mean? It's like you get Day Day saying, "Yo, could you listen to this record? I'm saying something very controversial, and I really want to say it." That doesn't, you go to any other chairman, they're not dealing in it like that. You know what I mean? They might have a meeting here or there. So at 300, I'm excited. I'm just, you know.
That was going to kind of be my next question, because I know back in 92 you say you saw Russell Simmons on the cover of Black Enterprise magazine. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to know, like, what's keeping you inspired?
With the hoodie.
Stay hoodie. Yeah. So I wanted to know, you know, 30 years in, like, what's keeping you hungry and inspired? You know, that's so...
Friends, artists, the culture, the changing model of business from a, you know, format change, and now it's just a consumption change and streaming. To different business models coming up. I'm an engineer by heart, so when there's a problem, I like figuring it out. So I'm not done yet. You know what I mean? At the end of the day, I think we've done some amazing things, but now it's about legacy. And you know, a lot of people say, "Well, Kev, damn, you did that." God has not given me my greatest venture yet. You know, and I don't know what it's going to be, where it's going to be, but I'm gonna keep plugging away where I can and keep giving back to the culture.
Right.
Damn.
Let's take it. So
I mean, we mentioned Lyor. I mean, a lot of people have never met him. Like, but what kind of person is he to you, and like, what kind of mentorship has he given you throughout the years?
I've been in it 32. I've been with him for probably 25.
Right.
And you were interning first when he was there, right?
Yeah, 91. Started interning. And I tell people, here's a guy that said your family, and I didn't start Def Jam. I was just there, you know, and I worked hard and became, you know, a part owner in it over the years. A guy who never treated me like an employee, a guy who always said, you're my partner. And you know, you hear that. I'm from Baltimore. You know what I mean? I'm not related to Russell or nothing. They said we look alike, but
yeah, you know. He's baby Russell back in the day. Yeah, you know, baby Russell.
The thing, so my credentials and my respect level came from the hard work that I put in. So when somebody says you're a partner, I really take it literally. Yeah. So I weigh his life, his family's life on my shoulders. Mm. He weighs my family's life on his shoulders. I don't look at, this is not, this like, you know, when he went down for a bit, you know what I mean? It was like, I'm somewhere and I had to fly back. You know, I'm on family vacation with my whole family. Nah, yeah. My man down. You know what I mean? Right. So, you know.
And you know this business, they want to be like, oh, he's finished or this person's out. You know how the industry is. Nah, they always want to kick you and, you know,
we ain't doing out of here. We ain't doing that. As long as I'm breathing, you know, Lyor, Russell, you know, Todd, Roger, all my partners, you know, we breathing. As long
you're
as.
Like the media, you're the mafia of the record company. Right. Like people know these names like Cohen, Liles, Moskowitz,
Greenwald,
Kaiser.
Yeah,
talk about family. That, like, because I think you guys get respect in a world where now artists, like, a lot of artists feel like, well, I don't need a record company, right? Like, I can get my own records out. Why do I need a record company? That type of stuff. But it seems like you guys still garner that respect.
We you know, Julie is not seen as a record company. She's seen as a hip aunt. You know, she's a Sarah Jessica Parker of, right. of music.
Pretty accurate.
You know what I mean? When you talk about Mike Kaza, Kaza is like, you know, Uncle Kaz, you know what I mean? He's going to always be at the hottest spots, going to be acting crazy, always. And
always got a drink for you.
And always got a drink for you. And when you lease this, you want to get somewhere and go somewhere?
Right.
Call Kaz. He'll have you on the floor here.
He got to connect. Yeah.
He got
the plug.
And the plug.
What about right. Moskowitz? A lot of people don't know about him, Todd Moskowitz.
Todd was there from, you know, early days. You know, Todd was like, you know, Lyor used to have this thing where he said, okay, Todd is going to be in my brain because Todd comes from a legal, you know, background, a lawyer. Julie's going to be my touch, taste, and tone, and Kevin, you're going to be my execution.
Mm.
So these, you hear the names, they all been around in some form or fashion for a period of time. And I've just been blessed to, I mean, even Roger Goh, who was with us at Warner and then moved with us here, Roger just, you know, brought us cheat codes, you know, and your audience might not know who they are, but look them up. They stream over 300 million streams, you know what I mean? And it's like, so when you have partners that believe in the movement and, you know, you talk about the mob, I'll just say, how about we be P&G? We have different brands around the world. Mm-hmm. And if you say, well, Kev, how you making stuff happen over there with Jay and them at Rock Nation, and how y'all doing stuff at this? No, we all together.
Right.
Y'all just they got different names on it, but we really have true family relationships. I care about the culture, so we move things as needed to make sure we're helping new entrepreneurs are coming into the business, but also protecting our culture at the same time.
Speaking of the business, Lyor has always been like the topic of controversy for the 360 deal. What are your thoughts about that?
I think it's all meshing into, and I actually, you know, helped build, you know, Warner's when I was there with them. I think if you think about the typical manager is somebody's friend. You know, typical manager is they met through somebody who's somebody. I have 30 years of experience. I can help empower you and help get you deals. It's like people saw what happened when I got with Trey Songz. You know what I mean? It's he gets a big deal with AEG. You know, he gets the cover of this. It's like he has great talent, but I kind of put it on steroids when you have great management. So 360 to me, if the companies are going to go to work and help more than just invest in an artist and empower an artist, I believe in the model. What I don't believe in is if people are not going to do the work. That's what I don't believe in. It's not about a tax. You know, I know in a new business, but I go to work. I always felt I managed everybody anyway, because if something went down, I got the call.
Yeah.
If something was, they had a child, I was there. Right. Whatever it was, I got the call anyway. So at the end of the day, my style has always been everything matters. And when you're in it with somebody, everything should matter. And so I applaud companies who invest in their artists and go to work.
But you think it's more so for like newer artists as opposed to seasoned vets?
Right? All depends on what you need in your life.
Hmm.
All depends on what I got. To me, if you grandfather contracts are the ones that don't have it in it, but all new contracts has some kind of form of participation, right? Because if Elliot Wilson starts, I'm talking like you're not here. If he starts Rap Radar, and then Rap Radar goes to do Rap Radar clothing, you know what I mean? And
right.
then
you've been trying to do Rap Radar clothing.
and then the reality of it, I helped invest in Rap Radar and built the brand. So now you go do Rap Radar clothing.
Where's your man?
Don't be jerking me, Elliot.
We're not doing that. You know what I mean? So now I believe in a model, but I also believe in putting in the work.
But you say,
go ahead.
You talk about the DIY, you know, model, but it's like, if that's the case, what's the role of managers and A&Rs and curators? Don't you think they're still important?
Absolutely. Listen, the biggest artists in the world have all those things. Hmm. The biggest ones in the world. Right. Name me one that don't have it. The biggest one. I'm not talking about a new person that maybe selling a million here. I'm talking the biggest artists in the world. They have all those things.
Hmm.
And so what I suggest when do-it-yourself, all do-it-yourself means to me, don't wait on nobody. Hmm. Look at what Young M.A. doing. Not waiting on anybody. Matter of fact, if somebody jumped in early, they might have fucked it up.
Right.
You know, so you do-it-yourself, that means you don't have to bury your entry. It's not there anymore. Just go do you. Mm-hmm. And trust me, when you do you, we're going to find you. If it's
I'm saying, how would you approach that? Like, you see a Young M.A. making noise, these type of artists. Like, what's your guys' approach and how you would try to get an artist to understand, a young artist who's starting to make noise, to understand the value that you can bring to their brand?
You got to show them something different. I mean, it's so similar to, you know, dating a girl to me, you know what I mean? Or a girl trying to get a guy. She'll put that dress on, you know, she'll make sure we cook them something.
Right.
You gotta show them something different. So I talk about, I don't need you to be signed to me. I don't need to manage you. But if you're gonna represent our culture, and artists will tell you, they're not signing me, I call them and I say, mm-hmm. I don't know if that was the right thing. And how about you tweak this? Because God gonna pay me back in a lot of different ways. So every new person that comes, even if they think they don't need me, I'll bump into them and I'll get a call. Oh, yo, we need this for freestyle. I said, no, but won't you call this person? And then they'll say, yo, Lyle said I should call you.
Yeah,
so
right.
you go to work. And when you go to work and people say, and that's what I think most of my artists love about me, they know I go to work. Yeah. You know, they're going to see me, man, you were up there with the president of the United States. So do you know Condoleezza Rice? Like, they're going to see me somewhere and ask me a question. And by the way, it's going to pay off that I know different people around the world for them.
But,
Trey's where is he at right now? Nairobi right now.
Kenya.
Yeah, so Kenya. Who are you? What's the management list now that you currently have that you're managing?
Well, you know, since things got... say fast track with 300, I had to slow down a little bit. So
yeah,
I got
you had everybody. Yeah, D'Angelo.
Right.
Well, I still got
him. Brought D'Angelo back?
Yeah, brought D'Angelo back.
How did you bring D'Angelo back, for example?
Well, I think D'Angelo wanted to come back after 15 years. But what his story was, you think I care about music and the sound of music and what people are doing? He's only interested in doing what God's saying to him at a particular time. His now album was named Black Messiah. When all the shit was going down in the street, you know what I mean? It's like you don't.
It's prophetic now, even more
you
so,
mean,
right?
You just look at him, but I mean, it's Trey, it's D'Angelo, PNB Rock, K Michelle, shit, I'm forgetting everybody, Jay Sean, somebody else I got four or five people. I'm sorry if didn't say your name, but KWL in the house. But you know, like
what made you think? Because like you, obviously a decorated executive, right? Mm-hmm. And then you probably argued with managers through your years and stuff like that to go on that side and be management. Like, what was that transition?
Never thought about being management. Mm. I just thought about doing what I do.
Yeah.
And if people remember, Trey was signed to Atlantic. I was executive vice president. And I met him when I got the street named after me. He came down because he was living in Baltimore, him and his mom came down. And so when he was going through his thing with his manager, I said, yo, isn't your manager Delonte, he said, yeah. I said, well, that was my first, one of my first interns in the business. Let me fix this. Like, you know, it's like, okay, let me see what I do. But it didn't work out. But then, you know, I said, go out and talk to other people and see, and then come back and I'll help you. He said, yo, people are concerned about commissions, not my career. I said, Jesus.
Wow.
And so his mom.
People are concerned about commissions not my career. Yeah.
And then he's, and his mom called me and said, Kevin, my son loves you. He loves the fact that you care about him. You care about us. You know, would you manage him? I said, I don't know about the man. I love him. I care about the kid. You know what I mean? He's like a son to me. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So let's see how it works. You know, 10 years later.
Wow. So that was the first act you managed, officially managed.
Officially managed, say, title managed. I don't even like call it, like how I have it set up. I set it up like corporations where he's the CEO and I'm the COO. Of all my clients. I'm the CEO. I have day-to-day managers that operate with them daily, but I have a board of directors, including the lawyer, business manager, the label. I put, you know, I just run it like a business, man. You know, we have summits quarterly and, but again, your value proposition is something different than other people. And, you know, even with Melvin Gordon, San Diego Chargers, or Jarvis Landry, you know, and the value proposition is just something, you know, different, you know, with what we do. And it's not you can't label it to me. I don't think it should be labeled.
Go back to the Def Jam, they're talking about bringing value. Like, what are some of the, like, so you've given us the picture of how Lyor had things set up, right, and the creatives that were there. In terms of dealing with those artists in the early 90s, like, what were some interactions or moments or maybe ideas you had that you saw executed and you started to feel like, oh, I'm really contributing and helping shape this company?
Well, I'll tell you the first, you know, F up that happened. You know, so I thought it was a great idea to do something called Def College Jam, Howard University. I take Biggie Smalls, Method Man, Redman, Onyx, and Boss. I think whatever
Boss. People forget about Boss. Yeah, right.
So then we. This is the height of. The Big Mac with Puff,
right? Flavin, yeah.
It was the hype of, and so I said, "Yo, I don't want to do it on the campus." So we rented a museum, and I put the Def Jam logo, like the bat sign, on the side of the museum. So it was only supposed to be 1,000 people. We had 4,000 people outside, people fighting to get inside. I almost couldn't get in.
Wow!
And then Method Man and Biggie did the what? $300,000 later. I don't do any shows in museums anymore.
They fucked up the Smithsonian or something?
Oh, man. When I tell you, we shut it down, but we paid for it too.
I heard the story then. Lyor was like, what did you learn from this?
Yeah, what did you learn from this? That was exact. He said, we have to. I said, Lyor, I got it. He said, but was the party hot? So to me, I always start with issues. I thought that artists would understand that together we're bigger than being separate. But then I realized, because the do-it-yourself is just a rejig of what people started, you know, what Russell did, you know, and what Sugar Hill did back in the day. So then we said, well, we know that Def Jam is an institution, so we have to break off pods right now. And that was the creation of Def Jam South, Def Jam West, Def Jam Japan, Def Jam London, Def Jam France, Rockefeller, you know, Murder Inc. and
Rough
those
Riders.
Things, Rough Rock. Like, and so
let's get to that, man. Let's get to that. The people love that era because you always keep such an even temperament. But you dealt with some very volatile guys, like Dame Dash, Irv Gotti, like passionate guys. Like relationships,
to me, what people missed. If it was me, they would have been the next iteration of Def Jam leadership. Me, if I was there and I stayed, I wanted them to have everything, every opportunity to be more than just the head of a label. I really wanted to help them, and I don't want to say groom or anything, but I'm really a giving person. I wanted them, and I learned a lot from them too. Yeah. So any of the volatility, it was, let's get to the real money. It was like, what's the, and so, you know, me, you know me, I really I have an ego, but more importantly, it's all gonna be based on what's the greater good. My ego is great based on the greater good. So the greater good, they two amazing individuals that had a passion for what they did. And I wish I could have spent more time, and God would have did more things that I could have helped them be, because I do believe that they were good for the industry.
I've heard like stories from like former artists, Ja Rule, Nori. Mm-hmm. They always say like you were one of the best execs. What was a Def Jam atmosphere like during that time?
I mean, you got to think, we were probably 60% of rap music. You know what I mean? It's like if you know, the only say competition was Death Row, who was great, Cash Money, mm-hmm. who was on the come up at that particular time, Bad Boy. You know, but we were, you know, we had them inside of our company. You know what I mean? So mm-hmm. to me, I was their friend. I guess I could put it, I wasn't an executive. I was their friend. Mm-hmm. I really went through shit with a lot of these guys. Right. Like things I can't talk about, but yeah. things.
Give us one you can't talk about.
I know one. Ja Rule. Ja Rule took DMX's car to Atlantic City.
I no comment. Listen, what I'll say is this. When X, I felt X. You know, I was with him when things, a lot of things, and he's somebody who, he's an artist that wears his heart on his sleeve. Mm. You know, I don't know how to be fake with that. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Ja was arguably one of the biggest melodic rappers in the world. You know what I mean? Ashanti at that time. Ludacris, who people thought he was just a radio personality and came out and sold 3 million albums the first time. And then came back and did it again. You know, these are people, even to this day, Todd, LL, to see him grow from at 15, 16 selling out arenas, mm-hmm. to see him now on 250 cities around the world, two shows, bigger than he's ever been as a personality. These are my friends. These are not artists to me. You know what I mean? Jay, we got a fantasy league. We play it. These are friends. These are people who every day, so I never look at the reason, I guess with the mutual respect is there because they weren't artists, they were people. Mm. I was helped groom young men and women that are, now have sons and daughters and have them go to school. So it's like, how can, that's not an executive, man. I don't play, this is life, man. I'm in it, Elliot. It ain't like.
But so much of the business back then was dealt with aggression, though, right? Mm-hmm. We were very aggressive in how we did business and stuff like that. So that's what people love. You know, you look at you with the Def Jam Jackets incident and those type of things. Like, they look at those passionate moments.
Jackets?
Like
I say. Jackets?
But you know what's funny? You know what's about to be that? You had to actually approve that to be shown, right?
Yeah, of course.
That's what's funny about it. So why did you allow it to be shown? And what do you think of that situation? And why did you put Rockefeller on the joint, too, man? You could have put a little patch somewhere.
No, because I never thought I owned Rockefeller. I thought Rockefeller was my partner. So at the end of the day, I never wanted to take anything from anybody. But if you really think about everything, Jay, DMX, Redman, and Method Man were all signed where?
Def Jam.
So to me, it was more so of a token of appreciation. And the reason I approved it, and people ask me all the time, why would you? I'm 32 years. Hmm. I'm Doug, Fetty Wap, Dre, I'm Diaz. I don't have to talk. I mean, I don't care about that. You know, I don't care. Anybody, you want to see what it is, see what it is. But when the smoke clears, all the noise clears, you will see that I'm the same person. I'm the same shit I was doing back then, I'm doing now.
Nah, man, you look crazy different now, man. You slim now, you're sexy.
I'm 150 pounds lighter. But that's all God, too, man. Think about it. God said, yo, stop being Benjamin Button. Stop getting younger. And I said, Kaz, I want to be in the best shape of my life right now because I don't want to miss God's blessing. Whatever he's preparing me for, think about it. We lost a lot of guys.
I wanted to talk about that.
To wait. A lot of my friends, you know, it was cancer or
at least the heart attack and diabetes and these type of things. And I just had a doctor's checkup. It just scares you. It's like, this is your cholesterol level.
Get your shit together.
This is your sugar level.
Y'all rap radians, you know, get y'all shit together. I'm telling you right now, it's about what you put in your body.
Yeah.
Simple. Do 20 minutes, 10,000 steps a day. I wear my Fitbit. Shout out to Fitbit. Give me a sponsorship. Make sure you walk 10,000 steps a day. Make sure you constantly, I do walk meetings. Sometimes I don't sit at the desk and I just walk around the office on the phone. People are like, but I'm getting my steps in. You know what I mean? And then I only, no fried foods, no caffeine, and no sugar. And again, I want to be around. Elliot, I got an 18-year-old that's in college now,
wow,
a 16-year-old that has 32 offers for different basketball scholarships, daughter. I have a 5-year-old, just turned, shout out to baby G, wow, 5 years old, happy birthday, and I have a 2-year-old. So what I'm doing, going to be 300-something pounds. I ain't going to be running around handling all that. No. No, I had to get my life together. And God scared me into getting my life together.
Because you went to the doctor and it was like, you got to get it together.
They said, yo, you fat fuck. You you greasy. You got diabetes. You got digestive problems. And I started to get a blood clot. Man, I'm telling you.
How big did you get?
320 pounds.
Wow.
If I did not change my life, I wouldn't be here. I definitely believe that. Yeah. And so I thank God and I'm thankful, and that's why I work so hard. Let's get in shape.
All right. I was gonna say, I was thinking about 1998. You said in an interview that was a hard year for you. Why was that?
Oh no, that speaks why I was thinking about too. I think you talked about it somewhere too, about the death of Biggie and Pac and how that affected hip hop and the dark time we was in a little bit right after that. Like, for people that don't really understand, like, talk about what that really meant for the culture and everything that was going on and how the business changed.
Man, it's like, again, you cut me open, I'm hip hop. So I'm living Pac, I'm living Biggie. I'm not only living it, I'm around it, you know? And the inspiration that they gave off it for the passion for their music and lyrics. And more importantly, it's somebody's son.
Right.
You know, I take it back to the realness of it. Yeah. Like everything
human
that's
beings,
happened
young
right
men,
now.
Young men,
young men.
B-Dot always talks about how young they really mid-20s.
Come on,
like,
man. Yeah. And so who wants that to happen? I mean, that no. And so it just made me, Scott LaRock.
Yeah.
You know, Chris Lighty, God rest his soul. I mean, come on, who wants that to happen? And this is why that year, and I had a couple of milestone years that made me reflect on things, but that year like bothered me a lot because I was still young too. I'm only 48, so you think about it, you know. I'm young and I'm becoming a man. And so I'm going through my own stuff. You know what I mean? I'm losing people and in the street, and you know, at the end of the day, I just felt like God had a bigger plan, and so I just started to change things and stop not saying something. It's one of the things that I regret. I didn't say enough. I wasn't vocal enough. I wasn't, yo, we getting money, guys. We don't own no coast. We don't own nothing. We get money. We get guys. And we raising kids. And we, come on, man, Big not here to see his kids, man.
Right.
What are you talking about? That hurt. It all hurt to me. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So what did you say when Lyor said we're putting out two DMX albums in 1 year?
We putting out two DMX albums in 1 year? we always try to do things differently and always try to set it off so people, and X just had, he had records. We could have put out three albums if we wanted to. But we wanted to try something different, and what do we say? We put Red Man and Method Man together, you know? And
Mumford and Man, that was you, right? Yeah. Mumford and Man?
It was a lot of us. I don't take credit for none. Like I said, we had a brain trust of people that worked hard, you know? And so whether it was, you know, Fat Farm, Def Comedy Jam, Def Poetry Jam, Def College Jam, video games. People don't know we sold 10 million games.
Wow.
You know what I mean?
That
people
Vendetta
don't know.
Joint? Huh? That Cam Vendetta?
It was Vendetta, Fight for New York, Icon, and what was it? Rap Star.
Wow.
Wait, people don't like,
wow.
I even.
That's 10 mil right there.
If you buy the 25th anniversary of Scarface when it came out, I did a little documentary inside of the actual, you know, Scarface movie, because Universal had the movie.
Oh, yeah.
And
I think I have this somewhere.
Yeah. So we always were doing different things. So I was just always excited to not just rest on what we were doing in recorded music. I wanted to do a lot of other things.
You said once in an interview, you said, like, the music comes first and the person has to have the it factor.
Mm-hmm.
Can the it factor be created if the person doesn't have...
You might get fooled. You might get fooled into thinking they have it. It's like a girl. You know, body might be banging and everything, but then you get to know and you're like, no. God might be a guy. Like, you think he hot and everything, but he got his friend's car and is staying at his mom's house. You know what I mean? It's that it factor is something that's consistent. That's something that whenever you see that person, it's like, you know, and again, shout out to Young M.A. She got that it factor.
I think he want to sign Young M.A.
No, listen. I respect people when they doing it.
Yeah.
Period. Period. A Boogie and them. I respect them. They're not signing me. Signed to my friends at Atlantic. Yep. But I respect people when they do it. I respect the if you got the it factor or you're evolving. into an it factor. Mm. You know what I mean? Thug. Thug says, I'm Prince. I'm gonna do whatever I want to do. Yeah. And I respect that thing that people have, man.
But there's still obstacles. I feel like for as big as Thug is, like, he still hasn't fully broken through yet. Like, why do you think that is?
Same reason it took Trey 3 albums to become who he was, and the same reason it took the Beatles, you know, 2 albums. It's just all different. Yeah. I don't want it fast. Anybody that gets it fast has a problem with making it last. Period. Bruce Springsteen, I'm talking about the greatest, Beyonce. Go to the greatest ones. They all got that longevity story. It did not happen overnight.
Yeah.
I don't want, by the way, I'm afraid for it to happen overnight because I don't know what that is. Mm. Nothing happens overnight. Kendrick Lamar didn't happen overnight. You can act like you just knew about it. J. Cole didn't happen overnight. So to me, I think where Thug is, he's in the process of being art. We don't just talk about Thug's music. We talk about Thug.
Right.
That's art. That's art to me.
But is that a good thing or a bad thing? Because it's like the music's come first, though, right? I'm not a
Thug
big
yet.
Young Thug fan.
Listen. I don't. My kid's going to private school. I don't care if he's sold on or not. It's one thing that will change nothing over here. No, the thing is.
No, but I think sometimes with Thug, right? I think the imaging something, you know, because we're so image conscious now and the visuals, like you said. So sometimes I think that people may not like Thug because of the imaging and those things. Like, so can you get to the heart of who this guy really is and why B-Dot should have a little bit more of an open mind?
I think, you know, I remember when I was coming up early and, you know, we used to joke Hammer.
Hmm. Yeah, make fun of Hammer. Hammer was supposed to be the cancer to the whole game.
I remember when we used to joke Michael Jackson.
Hmm. Yeah.
I ain't listening to B-Dot. I don't care what you're talking about. You understand what I'm saying?
It goes to my next point. Some people may not know that you are the writer of Milli Vanilli's Girl You Know It's True.
Can you sing it for us real quick? Definitely not.
If that happened today, would they survive?
Yeah, you know how big that scandal was?
That was huge.
Oh, my God.
They would have survived if they did the right thing.
Hmm.
I had five records on their next album.
Wow.
The pressure got to him. You know, I did the song, sold 100,000 copies. They did the song, sold 18 million.
Shit.
Obviously, the record was meant for them. You know what I mean? Yeah. So to me, I think they could have survived. Again, that's management.
And one of the guys passed away, right? Unfortunately, yeah. Right?
You know, that's management. That's who's around them. That's foundation. You know what I mean? That's like, I can't stress it anymore, man. Be careful who you have around you. Make sure you
and
have
And that's
a strong,
like a lot of things coming fast, like you said. That's the scary part.
And that thing, they were dancers. And just exploded around the world.
So what was it like then getting to like then meet them and like work with them? Like, what was that transition like? That must have been strange, no?
Man, I'm 16. I mean, back then. I mean, it was strange even having
You're like,
having
where the check at?
Yeah, having a record on the radio was strange to me back then. You know, when I was a rapper, they were telling me, we're only going to play rap music from 8 to 10 on Friday nights.
I remember that.
Okay, that's strange, yeah.
And you had to point your antenna to wherever the best way to get it was.
So to me now, to see the great world of streaming and on demand, and there's no person dictating what's hot, and you know what I mean, and the consumption of culture, it's just at an all-time high. So I'm excited. And all that, to where I am today, all those things in my life help me become, because I understand artists. I know, though, you can't tell me something I stole
because you wanted
you.
To be an artist at first.
No,
yeah.
I wasn't. Yeah. I didn't want to be. I was an artist. I opened up for LL Cool J.
Wow.
Run DMC, Salt and Pepper, Will Smith. I was on in Baltimore.
Wow.
The arena. I know what it is. They can't tell me, Kev, you know, they stole my song. I said, your song might have sold a million copies. How about 18 million? Come on, stole your song. You can't tell me. Studio, I had 3 studios already. What are you talking about? I was before 20. So I'm talking what I live with these
like,
kids.
Pick up the phone, it's ours.
Well, it's half of it.
Sorry, you know, Travis.
But it's just like, for me, man, I constantly want to do things that get people to say, look at them and separate myself. I'm not them. Don't compare me to any of those. My son was graduating this year, and I got my doctorate from Morgan State.
Congrats.
To help to say to him is more. You know what I mean? Mm. I'm going around, by my, one of my greatest talents right now is my daughter. I mean, there's 32 colleges, from Rice to Ole Miss, to want her to come play. She's only a junior.
Wow.
You know, so, but that's one of my greatest gifts. My 2-year-old, you know, my wife keeps saying, I want them to speak different languages, and you know, so I'm in French class, soccer. I mean, this is my greatest treasures, you know, right now. My kids, they're my biggest artists, you know what I mean? Right. And then with me, I'm getting to work with my friends. We never left each other, but we were doing different things.
Yeah.
But you know what it is to go to sit with somebody every day and you never have to worry about them going right or left? Mm. That you can't pay for that. That you can't even pay for that. That to me is my greatest, you know, excitement. I get to work with my friends, to have an amazing family, and guess what? We still here.
Right.
We still here.
What did you think? What did you make of when, you know, other execs were calling Lyor culture vultures, or, you know, other people that you've worked with?
Number one, no other executive ever called him a culture vulture.
Leave it at that.
Killer. The Shaquille O'Neal of the industry. all those things. But no, all jokes aside, I don't. You can't have a culture. You can't be a culture vulture, even considered like that, when you are pre-Run DMC.
Yeah.
A Suck MC. Right. What you
road manager, Run DMC.
You beastie. You can't. What do you mean? Your whole life has been about our culture. When I was down, my man was with me down. Mm. My first child, second child, third child, fourth child. I don't. You know now.
Yeah.
Should we have a greater responsibility for what we do every day? Hmm. Absolutely. But that's everybody.
Right.
And my man, you ain't gonna tell me he don't have that. Right. That's my brother. That's like, nah. Right. So and I look at it, we all make money off the culture.
Yeah.
So what's the issue?
Right.
Have you guys, like, there's always like this story about Lyor and aggression, like I was saying earlier, but it seemed like now we don't do business the same way. It's like people have made adjustments in how we do business. Can you speak about how maybe management style or even like personality wise you may have done business differently now as you're now in this stage of your career?
Just talking to him about this, you couldn't tell me what was hot from 91 to 2010. You couldn't tell me. I knew what's hot because I was in it every day. I was at the club. I knew what record. I knew the record was going to blend with the other record. You couldn't tell me. You couldn't tell me what clothes. I wore it. I was in France. You couldn't tell me what was hot. Four kids, big company, small company, entrepreneurship. Oh, it's some other things that's hot that I might not go to and might not know about. So now it's what Lyor did, having people around you and grooming them. And so for my last, you know, since 2010, I've been focused on people, focused on next generation. That's why, you know, I spoke yesterday at the National Association of Broadcasters. I said, young people, don't depend on somebody to give you something. Like these artists out there doing it themselves, do it yourself. Well, you want to create something, you got an idea, go do it. Figure it out. The money will come if it's a great idea. Do you think Zuckerberg asked? Do you think Bill Gates acts?
Right.
No, these guys are Snapchat owners, whoever. Nobody asked the kids that created YouTube, they didn't ask. No, they went and did it. So to me, I want those people, I want to find those people. I want to give them a platform to build. 300 is really just a platform for people, for artists, for executives, entrepreneurs, to build your shit.
Right.
Let's go get it. And we're gonna give you a platform and be there at the beginning to help you do it.
So what metric do you use as an exec for new artists? Like, do you sign people based off of popularity or the actual talent?
I think it's all of the above. I mean, I don't think it's one particular thing. Me personally, I gotta feel it. Mm. A song is supposed to do something to your body. Even you have an eargasm, or your head start to fall off, or you get up and dance. It gotta do something.
Right.
A song's supposed to do something. Now, if it's a ballad, it's supposed to make you feel a certain way. It just personally make you feel a certain way.
Yeah.
Like, what's Chance's record?
Problems.
Problem.
No problem, yeah.
I feel a certain way when that record come on. I don't care what nobody say. I make me feel a certain way. Right. So that's all I'm saying is like, when Trap Queen came out, I said, "How much hello?" I said, "What is he talking about? See you in his eyes." Oh, God. It made me feel. It just made me feel a certain way. I told me though that right there. I remember a young boy designer. Shout out to the designer. Came in the office, and he'll tell you the story. I said, "Yo, I don't know what they talking about. That you sound like people, and I don't know what people are talking about." That. But rap, rap. All I know is that I do loads and little. Like, that's a G. That made me feel. And again, like I said, I'm talking culture. Even if they're not signed with me, I'm okay with it, baby, because they know I was there. Yeah. They know, and I'm about people. Hey, guess what? We will be together if you want to be with me and I want to be with you. We will not be together
like I'm not going
if you want to be with me. I'm good with it. Next.
You once told Montel Jordan that you said if you want to sell a million records, touch a million people. In this era, does that still apply?
Absolutely, and you can touch them faster. Mm. So you're your own network. I tell all my guys, you are CBS, NBC, ABC, Showtime, Stars, be that, but you gotta program your network, period. You gotta program it every single day. Mm. That's your job. And so you'll see some people with 3, 4 million, 5 million, 20 million impressions. Some of, if you collectively put all our artists together, they're bigger than networks.
Yeah.
Period.
But some people are driven by the creative. I think what you said, one of your biggest things, Def Jam, is you brought the structure, you brought the infrastructure. Mm-hmm. Can you speak about any hints on how to, like, you have all these creative ideas, but how do you put it together? Like, you know, what's the direction to then go?
I mean, it's a process, but I look at everything as an engineer. So there's an A and a Z. You can get there a lot of different ways, but I'm more pragmatic about it. You know, my staff will tell you, I have a meeting about a meeting to make sure the meeting is right.
Right.
Then we're gonna make sure, I'll go, well, who's introducing this person? Okay, and why is that person, okay, is the person in the,
It
just has to be about that. So, and the greatest ideas happen different ways. Some are just, it happened. I always tell people this idea is about Snuggies. So when I was growing up, I used to turn my robe around and put my arms through my robe because that's how I was calling. I didn't think about Snuggies.
Right.
I didn't think about creating something because I wasn't from that mob. I didn't think that when I put pretzels and potato chips together because they taste good, I didn't think about creating something called Chetzels and selling it. When I was playing basketball, I never thought I could create the ball.
Right.
I never thought I could own the team. I just wasn't from the ball. But now, these days,
you see it that way.
What? I see everything as an entrepreneur. Man, what's happening with this Samsung phone right now? It's blowing up. Well, let's figure out what's inside. See, I know somebody owns a mineral company or something. You know what I'm saying? I look at everything as an opportunity. Entrepreneurship, Generation E, education, entrepreneurship, and empowerment. Everything has to be based on that. So when you talk about an idea, people come to me and say, can I work for you? I said, no, I really want to work for you. What's your idea? Mm. And what are you doing about it? Can't work for me. You got to create your job with me. Mm. So ask my man Alex over there. How long you been in the office?
10 months now.
10 months. When did you get a job?
Just now.
he started with creating reports and stuff. Like I said, yo, you know how to do that? Okay, you're valuable. You right. Got to create value, man. What's your value proposition to the business, baby? What is
value it? Value proposition. I like that word.
Wow. So what are your, I guess that's the same mentality you have for the interns, because a lot of interns these days they want to get paid.
They don't think they could work for free. Like, you know, speak on that journey of, you literally had a dream of going from an intern, unpaid intern, to running the whole company.
But he had money though.
I had money, but the point about it was, I was willing to get, wasn't about the money. It was about the opportunity. My man told me the other day, he said, yo, it's one thing to be able to get money, and it's another thing to have opportunity to make bigger money. I always said, again, the greater good, and I want your listeners to hear me. If you go at everything, your relationship, your job, your friendship, anything, if you think about the greater good, if you ask yourself, what is the greater good? You won't argue with your wife a lot because what you're talking about is nothing. You're really not talking about nothing. It's going to be over. And man, so I'm like, whatever. It's okay. When you're talking about kids, he only did 10 months. I did 2 years.
Wow. Unpaid.
Unpaid.
You had money in the staff.
I had money, but for 2 years.
Yeah.
But it was about the opportunity. Think about it. Who would do that? Who would take it?
No, he's saying nowadays the younger generation doesn't feel like they should intern for free.
Yeah, but I'm telling you, he just listen. Yeah. The right ones get it. The right ones get it. I hired three of them. How many? James?
Me.
You?
And that's it.
No, it's one more. One more at the company.
Oh, John.
This is live in action.
But isn't it also sometimes you get like a young person, like an intern, you kind of know right away if this person,
yeah,
in a week or two, you already kind of know.
Get rid of them. Yeah. No, what are you talking about? Listen, I had somebody, I'm not going to mention any names. If you're going to work for me, you got to be before me and go after me.
Yeah.
Wake up before me and go up. You got to be thinking for me. I don't care what position you in. Marketing, but don't let me find out an idea, something hot before you, and you in marketing. Right. I remember we was trying to come up with a name for a tour. We're making an announcement next week, our new artist tour. They actually was Young Hustle, you know, the tour. And now we're going to do a new one. Don't say the name yet.
Right. Yeah.
We're going to do a new tour. And so Lyor came up with a name. A couple of people came up with a name. He said, if by 6 o'clock, if nobody comes up with a better name, we're going with what I want to go with. Man, you would have thought people had thesauruses, Googling this and that, looking up every, and we came up with another name.
Yeah.
But it's the challenge of the greater good.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? The challenge of being great, the challenge of giving your best. I woke up today, man, at 6 o'clock flight, so I had to get up at 4:30 from Nashville. I did my shimmy on, put my white on. I said, damn, I feel good. I gotta go do something. I got my eyes, my arms, my hair, I can talk, I can breathe.
Right.
I gotta do something great today. So I'm challenging, you know, you hear my voice, you know, be great. Think about the greater good. And like I said, I'm not gonna minister or anything, but I am gonna tell you that when I say greater good, I'm really saying greater God.
Yeah.
You know, think about the blessings that we have. I don't chase money. Mm-hmm. I chase freedom. Freedom to do what I wanna do when I want it. And you gotta have money to do that.
Right.
But I chase the freedom. Mm. I want freedom. I want freedom to work with who I want to work with. We're moved mountains. Hit me on a test. Yo, Bobby. He answered him within 15 minutes.
Yeah, we did it fast.
I just got off a plane. No, I don't want to come and do it, but it's my man.
Right.
I move mountains, my man. I don't, you got to give me questions. No, it's my man. I'm talking to my man. It's a different, you understand what I'm saying?
Right.
So, but it's the greater good. Never ask Elliot to come, need to come do a talk about, no, I don't have, no. When he ready, we gonna talk.
Right.
The same thing, when I need him, do I have to?
Came down to Houston, you ready to come down to the show.
I call it relationship equity. But I got everything, man. I'm not, no.
Can you speak on that too, like give people advice? Because, you know, people approach you like with approaches and like, you know, put me on, that whole mentality.
Sales pitches.
Like, mm-hmm. And like, it just, what are some tips you can give people of how to approach people in terms of like to network? Because everyone knows networking is important, right?
Mm-hmm.
But most people do it very badly. So is there any advice you could give people how to approach people and get the opportunity?
I do it a couple of ways. So the first position in networking is play the wall. Who in the room? Now I'm talking about young. I ain't talking about me now. I'm talking about young.
No, we're saying young people.
Okay, young people. Yeah. Play the wall.
They want to get on.
You want to get on. So what you want to get on, a horse? Oh, you want to be in the music business. Play the wall. What that person, what does this one do? What's that one do? Play the wall. Then you come off the wall. Cause you see some fine thing going that you want to dance.
Mm.
See some position that you really want. So you start to mingle with that crew. Oh, you want to get into radio. So you start to show up at radio events. And then you meet somebody because you did something for somebody because you were just in that space.
Yeah.
Then you study. And then you go get your little network or your social media network and start doing that. If it's PR, if it's marketing, and start doing it. Mm-hmm. And then somebody like me gonna find you. I'm gonna be like, yo, what you doing over there? I like that. Who did that? I asked the question, who thought of that idea?
Right.
I'll be calling all kinds of people. P&G, Frito-Lay, I went Allstate yesterday. I said, so insurance, all my artists have insurance. So what if I got Fine New Roads, General Motors, Chevy, Fine New Roads, partner with Allstate, and we did a trip around the country to every great hip hop spot
and have them sponsor it. Lady said she loved the idea. I was in it. I wasn't playing the wall because I was thinking about it. I was there. So
you
young
people.
You
observed it first. Right.
I even play it now. You know, when I'm speaking, I'm like, who's the most important person in the room? Trust you, me. If I'm going somewhere, I'm next to the most important person in the room. Right. Great. Yeah. I think it's an amazing thing, but I know everything about him already. Mm. You know what I mean? You got this is not a game, man. If you really want to get in, because everybody can be in. Everybody can be in.
Yeah.
You can have a great, a girl said, well, how can I get my blog going? And I said, well, what do you do? I said, did you interview anybody here? She said, no. I said, you got 3,000 program directors here, owners of stations. You're in Nashville. You can go to a barbecue joint and bump into a country artist.
Right.
And you'll talk about your blog. And you live here too? Sure, you can't be around me. No, I will do that real fast in a hurry. My wife be like, well, you, why? I said, because,
cut him off cold. Daddy tells me that too. But you got to, you know, right away, man.
All I have right now is time. I don't live half my life. I know that. My time is valuable. Don't waste mine, and I'm not going to waste yours, period.
Can you speak on the transition of, you know, you rep hip-hop so much, and Lyor, you guys rep hip-hop, and corporate America, right, and building these relationships. There's always that tension between us, the culture, the negative and the culture. Like, can you talk about how you've grown as a businessman and learning how to deal with those corporations and corporate America and getting those meetings and how to,
used to be,
get what you want?
Mm-hmm. Used to be. But now, Valisha Butterfield is the head of African American outreach at Google. Lauren Wurster is the head of music partnerships at Instagram. Vince Hudson just took over the biggest brand at Diageo. Which one was that? I forgot the name of it. My other man is the president of the United States right now. Used to be that problem.
Yeah.
My other guy's the mayor of Atlanta. My other girl's the mayor of Baltimore. I mean, we used to have that corporation. My other guys, Zuckerberg, but I have a picture of young Bill Gates.
Mm.
You know what I mean? Because he wanted to feel how his products, me, LL, Quincy Jones, used to be. I don't have a problem now because all the guys that are there, one of my guys at Viacom, Scott Mills, came up through BET and the whole, that.
So these white executives that grew up listening to Wu-Tang.
We don't have that problem no more. The lady from Allstate, she's been there 30 years. We don't have that problem. Mm-mm. We make a girl, Pam, at NBA, CMO of NBA. We don't have those problems.
I need to meet with all these people.
Yeah, right?
I'm making a list. Roger Mason used to be a player at NBA PA. Demarius at the NFL PA. We don't have that problem.
Wow.
Owners, Mark Cuban, Jordan. We don't have that problem.
So if you meet the real executive that's kind of in the old school way, you just look at this guy, he's old school, you wouldn't do business with him? Like, I'm talking about the ones that are still resistant. Do they still exist at all?
I'm sure they exist, but you're
too empowered across the board.
Yeah, but I'll take it a step further. So I have a very good friend, Andre Williams. One reports to Kenneth Chenault at American Express. So through meeting on Kenneth and Ray and different people and different CEOs, we just have a relationship. So even though people might not listen to as much hip hop as me, trust me. And then guess what? If you really boss, you got a kid that's 16, 15, 18 that listen to my music. And you want me to have my artist come perform at your bar mitzvah. How about that?
Bar mitzvah game, it's crazy out here.
How about that? Or there's a product that you need. Yeah, it's all, and I'm telling you, and when I speak about hip hop, I'm talking about culture. It could be rock, anything that got an edge to it. To me, somebody wants to be involved. Presidents, princes, shout out to Lewis Hamilton. Mm-hmm. So the number one race in Formula One.
Right.
So whoever owns Formula One, they want to love him, don't they?
Right.
And he love hip hop. So we touch him. It don't matter who it is. It's that problem. I don't even think about having it anymore. Now, the responsibility, because we have the access, is where I have a problem, that we don't do the right things when we get in the door.
Mm-hmm.
We don't execute the proper way. We don't come up with the great idea, the greater good idea. If you know your artists really don't rep that, why you got them doing that? Why are you even, if you know you're really not gonna sing that song, another song should be in a place of that in the sink, and why you gonna do that? You messing it up for us.
So we have to over-deliver when we get into these positions. The head of Electronic Arts, when we started doing the games, he didn't listen to hip hop. But here's, he said, sitting around with the board, he said, I'm gonna tell you guys, I don't know anything about hip hop, but we're gonna do games with Def Jam. And here's Kevin. I asked my son and my daughter, do they know? And they gave me a whole list. We're gonna build games with these guys. Wow. That's how the games happen.
Wow, just like that, 10 million later.
Electronic Arts. You tell me,
right.
How do you think Russell got into HBO? How do you, listen, everybody know we raised money to start 300. You know what I mean? One of our biggest investors is Google.
Right.
What you mean? Yeah, we got access, man.
But it always still comes back to Baltimore, man. It's funny because as we wind it down, I ran to this young brother even coming up in here, and he was saying that, I was like, so Kev's really still a big deal in Baltimore, right? Like, he's really the guy. Da, da, da. And then he was telling me about there was actually some young artist named Laura Scooter, I think, that passed away recently.
Yeah.
And, like, how that affected the community and stuff like that. And, like, I think you had a rapport with him. Can you speak on that and, like,
oh, man, just that shout community? Out, shout out to Laura Scooter, man. I mean, shout out to all I mean, if you lost somebody, you know, I'll say a special prayer after this. But more importantly, B-more, man, that's like,
it's a tough city.
You know,
right?
you can't, people know. You know, I've been in New York for 25 years now. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But you cut me open, I'm B-more. You know, it's the B-more Kev, they call me. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? I lose somebody. The kid wanted to be signed to me. Mm-hmm. And so I was, you know, just talking to him, because he wasn't ready yet, but talking to him. How do you think that make me feel? But again, that's somebody's son. That's somebody's brother.
Yes.
That's somebody's friend.
Right.
To make me feel even worse. That. And you talk about, you know, my city, this ravage. You talk about Chicago. You talk about all the stuff that's happening right now. You know what I mean? We are in a sense a state of emergency as a culture. And as black men, we have a responsibility to step up and stand up, you know, right now. So that's, again, there's a lot of pain right now, but we have a lot of work to do.
Yeah.
And so I'm going to always use, you know, I say where success comes responsibility. So, you know, B-more will always have a special place in my heart. But people from my culture, I'm always going to be there, you know, for them.
Right.
I think you got to go, Sue B-Dot. You got anything before we get out of these holding his phone?
Oh, right. I have a board review call. We haven't called 854. We haven't called.
I got a superficial question, though. Mm-hmm. Being that you wrote Girl You Know It's True, a big record, what are the residuals like for a song that big?
I did that in 86, I think. 30 years later, I just cashed a check yesterday.
Oh, my God. How many zeros or commas?
I'm not gonna tell you that. I don't wear my money or talk about my money. I never do that.
I'm gonna do
that.
It for you.
I'm blessed. I've been able to. My sister has a master's degree in engineering. Two sisters with master's degrees in engineering. My son's in college. You know, my wife got a couple of businesses, and we live okay.
Wow. You said you could DJ back in the day. What was your best routine?
I can DJ today. Stop that.
What did you cut? Peter Piper? Like, what was your routine? Like, what's a good mix that you used to
Kev? I think I went from, I was mean with Jam Master J, Run DMC, Chicka Jam. I was mean with that one. Kick off your show. I was mean with that. And then the Rockwilder Rim Anime, I was mean with that. Mic up, check up. Mean.
So you could do a party right now? Like,
oh, absolutely.
He's ready. I feel like you back
there. I used to have 1,200s in my office.
Wow. We got to get you. We got to do a party.
Five, top five favorite, personal favorite Def Jam records.
Come on, man. Yeah, you,
top five.
How you
before we get out of here. Fun you, note. You're a hip-hop head, man.
G, Paul Revere, Beasties. Run MC.
Well, say why a little bit to the thing. Why Paul Revere?
Paul Revere, it made me Beasties. Feel a certain way. I don't know. I mean, I'm just saying, it's okay. Method Man.
MBTHOD Myth?
Great record.
Gee, Monetti.
Shout out to Hall & Oates.
who else? LL, I'm Bad. Mm-hmm.
Give me that walkie-talkie.
Public public Enemy, Fight the Power.
Woo.
Jay-Z, Public Service Announcement.
Classic.
That's five.
I mean, you're Slick Rick.
Children's Story.
I'm
Rules Back.
Yeah, I can go. But I'm going to tell you now, one of the records that was so big, are they doing a call? Or no, are they on it? They on the call?
No.
Okay. One of the records that was so big, and people might not, when we did Def Soul, you had Montel Jordan that had a record, This Is How We Do It. Mm. You had Cisco with Thong Thong.
Huge records.
You can't even explain what those records were. And a lot of people don't associate them with Def Jam, but it was Def Soul, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And when Music Soul Child came out and said, so when CBX for five, I can just tell you, it's so many that Ludacris throw them bows.
Right.
Gee, Redman's Time for Some EPMD, how can you ask me to even do that? That's like,
that's what well,
Kanye
how about
West
this?
Gold Digger.
What's your greatest Def Jam moment for you as an exec then? When something that sticks out in your mind that you're really proud of? I know there's a lot.
96, they said, we want you to be the president of Def Jam. I said, I can't. I don't know the whole country. I don't know it like that. And the building is not set up for a kid from Baltimore to come in and be the president of the company. Hmm. Asked me again. I wasn't ready. In 98, didn't give me a choice. And they made me the president and CEO.
Wow.
Proudest moment of my life. But at that particular time.
Wow.
That particular time. Proudest moment of my life. You think about being an intern and then running the whole place? I'll give you.
Take us home, Kev. We out.
Don't miss this.
Take us home.
In life, God will always have something great waiting for you. He did it for you in multiple ways. He's always shown me when I was All-State football and I stopped playing, became All-State intern, became All-State president and CEO, became executive vice president, one of the highest-ranking African Americans in the entertainment business. Left, got married, two more kids, started 300, KWL, all points. And I'm telling you, that's why I'm getting in shape again. Something about to happen. I don't know what it is, but God got me so excited again, and I'm in these streets. I mean, I'm really meaning. I'm not playing. I'm nice guy and everything, but I'm not playing. I have the gloves and the mask on, and we go get at it.
That's what's up.
All right, Kev. Thank you, brother. Right, man. So many gems, man.
Bless you guys.
Yes. Rap Radar Podcast.